Good evening. Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be back here for the third in this series of lectures. I'm impressed that so many of you came here on this freezing cold night. Right, why Putin? Years and years ago, it always used to annoy me when journalists and analysts became obsessed with the personality of the leader of Russia, you know, speculating about his taste in whiskey or his wife's fashion sense or lack of it, and using these little elements of his biography to make judgments about him. Nevertheless, in analyzing Russia today, we are once again confronted with an inescapable fact, and namely that the personality and beliefs of Vladimir Putin, the current Russian president, matter just as much as those of his predecessors, if not more. In a state where authority is still vested in individuals and not in institutions, the president of Russia's vision of his country, his understanding of its history, his education and training and background, and his personal experience of life in the Soviet Union and in contemporary Russia now have an incalculable impact on Russian political life. And as if that were not enough of a reason, I have another reason why I want to talk about the personality of Putin to start out with, which is that I feel that I spotted him early, back when he was still prime minister during the presidency of Boris Yeltsin. And what caught my eye at the time was a visit he made soon after his appointment to that job to the Lubyanka in Moscow. And once the headquarters of the KGB and its most notorious jail, the Lubyanka is now the home of the FSB, Russia's Internal Security Services, an institution which Putin himself directed before being asked to head the government. He visited the Lubyanka in 1999 on December the 20th, a day still known and still celebrated by some in Russia as Chekist Day. It's the anniversary, and that was the 82nd, of the founding of the Cheka, which was Lenin's secret police, the institution that was later became the NKVD and later the KGB. And in that place and on that day, so redolent of the bloodiest pages of Russian history, Putin solemnly unveiled a plaque in memory of Yuri Andropov. Nor was this an accidental gesture. Later, as president, Putin ordered another plaque placed on the Moscow building where Andropov had lived, and he also erected a statue to him in a St. Petersburg suburb. Now, for Putin, who's a man who pays nowadays extensive lip service to the theory of democratic elections and indeed the practice, Andropov would seem an odd hero. Andropov was the longest-serving director of the KGB, holding that office from 1967 until 1982, the year when he briefly became general secretary of the Communist Party. But unlike some of his predecessors, Andropov was not just some faceless apparatchik or aging party hack. He had a very straightforward theory of governance. So in Soviet terms, he was a modernizer, but not a democrat. So on the contrary, having been the Russian ambassador to Budapest during the Hungarian Revolution in 1956, Andropov understood very precisely the danger which democrats and other free-thinking and self-organizing groups posed to totalitarian regimes. He also understood simultaneously that, like everyone else in the KGB, that the Soviet economy was lagging far behind that of the West. At the time of his death, he'd come to the conclusion that something had to be done about this, and the conclusion was that order and discipline, as enforced by the methods of the KGB, and that included the fight against alcoholism, laziness, and corruption, coupled with the use of carefully targeted violence against dissidents and other representatives of potentially disruptive small groups, would restore the sagging fortunes of the Soviet economy. Now, Vladimir Putin not only came of age in Andropov's KGB, an organization that he first tried to join by his own account at the age of 15, but he shared some life experiences with the man who later became one of his heroes. As ambassador to Budapest, Andropov had been shocked when young Hungarians first called for democracy and then protested against the communist establishment, and then took up arms against the regime and, not coincidentally, lynched several secret policemen. Putin had a similar experience in Dresden in 1989, where he witnessed mass street protests and the ransacking of the headquarters of the Stasi, the East German secret police. Somebody reminded me today that it is a story told about him is that he was one of the people standing in front of the Russian compound in Dresden, the sort of Russian KGB compound, where he talked a mob out of sacking that building too. Whether that piece of it is true, it is certainly the case that German colleagues of his, as he recalled years later, had suddenly lost their jobs and their privileges from one day to the next, and this was very shocking. Now, both Putin and Andropov drew the same conclusion from these traumatic experiences. You know, talk of democracy, even when it seems on a pathetic and small and unimportant level, can lead to protests. Protests can attract more followers. The more followers can lead to bigger protests, which lead to attacks on the Chekists. So better to stop all talk of democracy before it gets any further. And as a result, order and discipline are now words in Putin's vocabulary too. Now, this is not to say that Putin is Andropov or that Putin wants to bring back the Soviet Union. But it does mean that Putin, and more importantly, most of the people around him, is steeped in the culture of Andropov's KGB. This is where he was educated, just in the way that someday people will say of the students in this room, you're steeped in the culture of the early 21st century LSE. But what does this mean in practice? You know, at the most fundamental level, he and the people around him believe deeply that the rulers of the state, of the Russian state, must exert careful control over the life of the nation. So events cannot just be allowed to happen. They must be controlled and manipulated. By the same token, markets cannot be genuinely open. Elections cannot be unpredictable. And the modern equivalent of the Soviet dissidents, the very small groups of mostly urban activists who sometimes oppose centralized Kremlin rule, must be carefully controlled through legal pressure, public propaganda, and if necessary, carefully targeted violence. So just like their Soviet predecessors, Putin and the men around him also assume that anyone not supportive of their regime is by definition suspicious. This is an inherited paranoia, and probably a foreign spy. So at a rally as long ago as 2007, Putin declared that, and this is a quote, "Unfortunately, there are still those people in our country who act like jackals at foreign embassies, who count on the support of foreign friends and foreign governments, but not on the support of their own people." This, and I'll come back to it later, was a direct warning to Russia's few remaining human rights activists, trade union activists, as they well understood. It was also a comforting signal sent to Putin's followers, who continue to believe, like Soviet secret policemen before them, that all important decisions are best made in Moscow by a small, unelected group of people who know how to resist these foreign conspiracies. His concern about foreign influence has not faded during his years in power. On the contrary, on the night of his third and most recent re-election to the presidency last year, Putin described the protesters who had thronged the streets of Moscow for a few weeks in the previous winter in very stark terms. He'd won the election, he declared with great passion, you know, tears welling up in his eyes. And he said, "We showed that our people can distinguish between the desire for renewal and a political provocation that has only one goal, to destroy Russian statehood and usurp power." So Putin doesn't merely dislike his democratic opponents, in other words, or his opponents. He believes they are sinister agents of foreign powers. He doesn't just object to the liberal political system they claim to support. He believes they're plotting to destroy Russian statehood, usurp power, and hand the country over to rapacious outsiders. Now, maybe it's just talk, but I believe that it would be a mistake to believe that this kind of talk is mere propaganda. In the past few years, as historians have had more access to Russian archives, it's become ever more clear that Soviet leaders often meant what they said, even when they were using what sounds to us like absurdly ideological language. So without any evidence to the contrary, we should assume that Putin means what he says too. But although I find Putin's character and life experiences fascinating, and although I am particularly interested by the language he chooses to use, these things are really only important because they help us understand the nature of the regime which he's created and over which he now presides. So remember, this is a man who held influential positions in the 1990s, ahead of the KGB, prime minister, ahead of the FSB, sorry, prime minister, and who has, in practice, functioned as his country's leading politician for 13 years since 2000. according to his interpretation of the Constitution, he's allowed to remain in office for 11 more years until 2024. So he might well have the chance to dominate Russian politics for a full quarter of a century. Now, searching for a way to explain the system that he created, some people have used the expression managed democracy. Others refer to it as corporate capitalism. Since I think it's a bit of both, and since I do think it's also closely aligned to the culture of the 1980s KGB from which Putin emerged, I am not very originally calling it Putinism the ideology. And yes, I am using the word ideology with great deliberation, for although there aren't tomes and tomes of books written about it, as there once were about Marxism, this is a carefully worked out system with carefully designed institutions. It's deliberately taught to Russian children. It's promulgated to the voting public. It's propagated in the media. Putinism is the basis for Russian foreign policy, and it comes complete with an interpretation of the past and predictions for the future. It even has an ostensible goal, which it proposes to make Russia strong and feared again, and it promises, this is for insiders, to protect the power and the wealth of Russia's ruling class. It's not immutable. On the contrary, it changes under the pressure of events, just as Marxism and Leninism once did. At the moment, it is realigning itself to cope with the fact of the new and somewhat louder and better organized Russian opposition. But what is it? Well, clearly the most central element of Putinism, at least until now, has been the carefully managed electoral process, the managed political parties which take part in that process, and the managed results. So there's nothing remotely unique or especially Russian about falsified elections. Let's just say that such things have been known to happen in the most democratic of democracies as well. Nor is the phenomenon of a leader anointing his successor, as Putin did to Medvedev, and Medvedev to Putin, is that completely unheard of either. Look no farther than Tony Blair and Gordon Brown. But the Russian manipulation of political outcomes has gone far deeper. Though even Gordon Brown eventually had to face his electorate, in Russia, voters are at no stage allowed to intervene in the democratic process. You know, there are no accidental victors in Russian elections because there are no accidental candidates. Instead, the semblance of choice has been carefully preserved, not just through the advanced choice of the winner, but through the advanced choice of his opponents as well. Because they do not want Russia to appear to be a one-party state, the Kremlin ensures that there are always several candidates from several parties, some of which have been especially created to look like opponents of the status quo. So the revival of the fake opposition party, a phenomenon familiar from communist Eastern Europe, is one of Putinism's great contributions, if that's the correct word, to modern political life. Now, the best and sort of oldest example of this is one of the most famous, Vladimir Zhirinovsky's Liberal Democrats, this very confusing title of his name of his party, which has been known to, which at one point made the German Liberal Democrats feel they should be allied with him until they worked out that that was the wrong group. But this is a group which routinely won parliamentary seats by sounding more nationalist and more extreme, even to the point of absurdity, than the mainstream Kremlin parties. But somehow, when push came to shove, Zhirinovsky's party inside the Russian parliament, inside the Duma, always voted with the Kremlin. More recently, the Kremlin has tolerated weak and certainly unpopular opponents, such as the oligarch Mikhail Prokhorov, who was allowed to stand against Putin in recent elections, though he had no chance of success. So by contrast, the Kremlin's genuine opponents have been marginalized, beaten up at demonstrations, jailed, harassed, and insulted. The Other Russia, which was the political grouping created by Garry Kasparov, the former chess champion, was once described on the state-owned website pravda.ru as a, quote, motley army of deviants, criminals, wannabe politicians, fraudsters, and gangsters on the fringes of Russian society. So it's nice and clear. More recently, this is following last winter's demonstration, judges have handed down jail terms to political demonstrators for plotting, quote-unquote, mass unrest. Police have also raided the homes of opposition leaders and lawmakers, have increased fines for illegal protests, so-called illegal, recriminalized libel, and expanded legal definitions of treason in order to control their opponents. But Putin has long had ambitions beyond the mere creation of political parties. It's also aimed successfully or otherwise, to create organizations which we in the rest would, in our context, would refer to as civil society, or sometimes as non-governmental organizations or NGOs. So again, to repeat, because of their background and training, the men around Putin view all kinds of environmental, educational, and charitable institutions not as a normal aspect of a functioning democracy, but as evidence of secret networks probably involving Western spies. Don't laugh. At the same time, the Kremlin has encouraged state-controlled youth groups, state-controlled trade unions, and even state-controlled organizations dedicated to the promotion of democracy. Several years ago, I was asked by an acquaintance at the U.S. Embassy in Moscow to speak at a seminar on civic education for high school teachers, which was being held at something called the Institute for Democracy. So I went, and I gave a short, fairly predictable speech about Western journalism, of a kind I've given many times in Russia before to other kinds of groups. And immediately the audience attacked me. And the first questioner wanted to know, why does America support Chechen terrorism? Another asked me how I, as a representative of the Washington Post, which I then was, which they said was widely known to be a U.S. government-controlled newspaper and a mouthpiece of the White House, how could I even come there and speak about a free press? Well, you know, the audience went on parroting this very really extreme version of this kind of neo-communist, anti-American propaganda, which actually now more frequently appears in the Russian press and then was a little bit more surprising. I was very surprised by it. And afterwards, I asked the organizer to explain to me the origins of the Institute for Democracy. Ah, yes, it was, she told me, actually an older organization, formerly known in Soviet times as the Institute for World Peace. Though it had a new title, it was under the same direction, same guy was still running it, and it operated according to the same principles. In other words, it taught students to follow whatever government line was currently in fashion. Once that was international communism, and now it's democracy. So, I don't know, I would guess that the perks proffered by the Institute for Democracy, I don't know what it was, a free trip to Moscow, free meals, maybe a stipend, encouraged many of the participants who were, by their own account, mostly provincial high school teachers, and that presumably encouraged them to attend the seminar. But I suspect they'd made an ideological decision as well. You know, they came from that part of society which, like Putin's entourage, preferred the more orderly world of state-organized civic society to unconstrained individual liberty, from the part which believes, as the Russian press frequently state, that non-government groups who promote democracy are by definition Western spies. Now, this same group of people are also no doubt attracted to another equally original element of Putinism, namely the managed press. This is not the censored press, it's the managed press. So in his media policy, this Putin has, at least for the most part, deviated from the methods of Andropov and his Soviet colleagues, who simply locked up all critics, censored everything, and made sure that everything that appeared in public was according to the party line. Nowadays, the system is different. Theoretically, the press is free up to a point. You can, for example, publish a small independent newspaper as long as it remains very small. You can function as an independent journalist so long as you don't publish anything that truly endangers the status quo. Nevertheless, there are limits, for just as the press knows it has a certain sphere of freedom, it also knows that if its circulation goes too high or its reporters' questions become too uncomfortable, then official attitudes will change. Some years ago, when traveling in the Volgograd region, I met an attractive young woman journalist who worked at a local television station which was owned by the regional government, as most local television stations in Russia are. So we talked about press freedom and all the exciting opportunities open to young journalists, and she, I think, wanted to go to the West and study, and I was very impressed. And then I asked her what would happen if she, on her local television station, broadcast something critical of the local governor. And she looked at me as if I was an idiot. She said, they would shut us down. You know, what do you think? So, sometimes controls are less subtle. Novaya Gazeta, this is the one Moscow newspaper which still criticizes it, mostly it's anti-corruption, but also criticizes Putin and the Kremlin directly and indirectly, has had its journalists beaten up, its offices broken into, and its accounts audited again and again. Anna Politkovskaya, who is Novaya Gazeta's most famous and most talented reporter, was murdered several years ago in the middle of the day in the stairwell of her own apartment building under very suspicious circumstances. So with tactics like that, there's no need to shut that many newspapers down. And in fact, the Politkovskaya case illustrates rather well how Putinism has worked. So it doesn't eliminate all real political opponents. It only eliminates those who become too famous or too popular. It doesn't use mass violence, but to repeat, it uses targeted violence on the grounds that if the arrest or murder of a single person is well known enough, then that might be enough to scare hundreds of others. Politkovskaya was allowed to function for many years, actually, and wrote some very brilliant books and articles, but she was killed when her investigations brought her too close to the truth about Putin and some of the complexities of the Chechen War. Mikhail Khodorkovsky, the oil magnate, who had been allowed to get rich in the 1990s, was arrested by Putin when his money made him too independent. The women of Pussy Riot were allowed to stage protests. This is a more recent story. But when they began to attract real notoriety, they were sent to labor camps. So thus, at least until recently, Putin has been able to exercise greater control over the remaining oligarchs, the remaining journalists, and the remaining protesters. You know, without Stalin-style mass arrests, would-be regime opponents can be intimidated into silence and cooperation because no one wants to share the fate of Politkovskaya, Khodorkovsky, or the women in prison in Siberia. Now, the Putin ideology does not operate in a vacuum. As Marx said, and he said many wise things, base determines superstructure. The economy impacts the society. And there's no doubt about the fact that Russia's carefully managed democracy is fueled, funded, and supported by a carefully managed economy. It is, and it has been since 1991, a mistake to call this system capitalist, although it possesses some apparently capitalist institutions like stock markets and banks. Because, in fact, the resemblance is superficial. In truth, Russia is not a capitalist society. It's a rent-seeking oil economy, one which resembles Saudi Arabia far more than the United States or Western Europe. But even as an oil economy, Russia is an original one with distinctly Putinist elements. As in Saudi Arabia, the nation's largest companies and banks, Gazprom, Lukoil, Rosneft, are owned by a small group of people. Yet these owners are not an official ruling family like the House of Saud. Instead, they are a subset of Putin's inner circle. So some of them hold double jobs as government officials and captains of industry. Other magnates share their wealth with the politicians in order to stay on top. Economics is politics and vice versa, although not always in a transparent manner. Oligarchs can and do fall out of favor. The richest men in Russia are not the same as they were 10 years ago, but it isn't always clear how or why. So since taking power, Putin has taken this system, which was first created under Yeltsin, and he's turned it in his favor. So although he sometimes speaks of economic reform, he's actually not interested in creating a legal system which would encourage entrepreneurship on a broad scale or a banking system that would help small and medium-sized enterprises grow. Instead, he's presided over an enormous transfer of assets from the state and from other oligarchs to his friends and probably himself. So the trial of Boris Berezovsky versus Roman Abramovich, which was staged in London last year, some of you may have read about it in the papers, was in essence the public airing of the bitter dispute between a Yeltsin-era oligarch who lost much of his fortune to a Putin-era oligarch. Yet if Putin and his friends have made themselves extremely rich, and if they control print and television media, and if they control the police and the army, then why does the Russian president bother with the fiction of democracy? You know, given their wealth and power and apparent security, why should Putin, Medvedev, and the ex-KGB men around them need all of these elaborate games and facades? You know, why does Putin hold elections at all? Why didn't he just appoint himself president? You know, why maintain all of this pretense? The answer to this, as I hinted earlier, is what I think is the key to understanding the nature of this regime. So remember, Putin's goal is to maintain dominance of his clique. And for some time now, this ex-KGB inner circle have believed that the greatest threat to their power and control and their money is not the West as such, but Western democracy rhetoric. So Putin and Medvedev do not, and they cannot possibly seriously fear Western military attack, you know, that NATO and the Belgians and the Portuguese will get together and invade. Putin made it that they do fear popular discontent. They fear the public questioning of their personal wealth. They fear the open criticism of the basic tenets of Putinism, and of course, political demonstrations of the sort that created the Orange Revolution in Ukraine and those which happened on a smaller scale after the parliamentary elections in the winter of 2011. Now, to stave these things off, they believe they have to work hard to maintain their legitimacy, both at home and abroad. So during his, for example, during his 2008 election campaign, it's true, Medvedev did not travel around the country and he did not meet with supporters. Nevertheless, a campaign atmosphere was created. People were encouraged to vote, the media covered the election story, and all the trappings of democracy were present, even though we all knew who would win. The same thing happened in 2012. Putin refused to take part in debates on the grounds that to do so would impede his ability to duly carry out his duties, in the words of his spokesman. Yet the campaign, once again, was a matter of public discussion, debate. For all of his professional wariness of the real thing, Putin continues to adhere in word, if not in spirit, to the language and to the appearances of democracy, and indeed these appearances matter to him enormously. The appearance of democratic politics, democratic discourse, and capitalist economics, and it's really this which gives his regime its novel and deceptively powerful ideological edge. The need for legitimacy has also inspired some of Putin's harsher rhetoric about the West and especially about the United States. So more than once, he's accused the United States of encouraging the spread of weapons of mass destruction and encouraging terrorism. We all forget these kinds of comments because they often get thrown away, but he has openly compared America to Nazi Germany. He recently set up an institution designed to monitor democracy in the United States, and he frequently accuses both Americans and Western Europeans, especially the British, of hypocrisy of various kinds and human rights violations. Now, this rhetoric serves several purposes, but above all, it is designed to inoculate the Russian public against the example of more open societies. Underlining this rhetoric is the Putinist interpretation of history. Famously, we all know this, the ex-Russian president once described the breakup of the Soviet Union as the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. He's also displayed Soviet flags in anniversary parades, and he's brought a neutral version of the history of Stalinism to Russian textbooks. More importantly, Putin has spent much of the past decade trying to promulgate an alternate post-Soviet history. So in his version of events, 1989 and 1990 was not a moment of liberation, but it was the beginning of economic collapse. And the hardships and deprivations which Russians genuinely experienced during the 1990s were not the result of decades of communist neglect and of widespread theft, but of Western-style capitalism, democracy, and Western economic advice. You know, communism was stable and safe, and post-communism was a disaster. You know, the Soviet Union was great, at least within some parameters, and Russia was, until Putin's arrival, a failure. The Soviet Empire, launched in 1945, was a moment of triumph to be remembered proudly, and the blood and terror required to achieve it are forgotten. The more people believe all this, the less likely they are, and this is what I assume is the case, the less likely they will be to want a system which is more genuinely democratic and genuinely capitalist. So the more nostalgia there is for Soviet-era symbols, especially imperial symbols from the year 1945, the more secure the KGB clique is going to be. This context makes Putin's harsher verbal attacks on some of Russia's neighbors easier to understand, too. In the past, his most vitriolic rhetoric has been reserved for those countries which most successfully navigated the path from communism to open societies, and which maintain the most open and most pro-Western political systems, Poland, Estonia, until recently Georgia, and until recently Ukraine. So it's highly improbable, for example, that Putin ever feared the missile defense shield which President Bush wanted to place in Poland, and it's impossible to believe that he was truly intimidated by NATO's somewhat pathetic relationship with Georgia. But he is afraid of the example set by these countries since they challenge his own country's geopolitical choices and they offer an alternate narrative, and American support for them has infuriated him. Russia's foreign policy towards the post-Arab Spring Middle East is also dictated in part, I believe, by concerns for legitimacy at home. You know, Russia's behavior in Syria is, in this sense, highly ideological. You know, again, although Russian diplomats are openly contemptuous of Assad, and although Russian economic interests, when you look at what they really are in fact very narrow, it's clear that the Russian government, in the wake of the successful Libyan revolution, does not want to see another authoritarian state toppled by a popular revolution. It's just too close to home. Nor does he want to see another victory, quote-unquote victory, for the Western democracies or for what might be broadly understood as a Western political movement, although how Western they are, who knows. But that he fears that it undermines his own authority and his place in the world. Now, Russia is not alone in fearing the democratic example of the West and in preferring, therefore, to see authoritarian regimes around the world succeed. And although there have been a lot of arguments about whether Russia does or does not have so-called soft power, it's true that Putinism as a model does have a great deal of appeal in many places, Central Asia, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Kazakhstan, but also in Iran, in Venezuela, and elsewhere. You know, the Iranian president, Ahmadinejad, took a leaf out of Putin's book a few years ago when he held an academic conference in Tehran to discuss the Holocaust. And he invited a number of famous Holocaust deniers. So he declared this an opportunity for thinkers who cannot express their views freely in Europe about the Holocaust. You know, so if the West is going to shelter Iranian dissidents, in other words, then Iran will shelter David Irving and David Duke, just as Russia will sponsor institutions which investigate democracy in the United States, and Russia, of course, will give passports to roaming French actors who don't like the tax regime at home. Now, Putinist politicians and businessmen have also tried, and again with some success, to gain influence abroad through the spread of Putinist-style corruption. Often they've done so with the help of Russian oil and gas companies, you know, and through commercial transactions. You know, again, at the moment, Russia's the company Lukoil controls refineries in Ukraine, Bulgaria, and Romania. It has assets in Greece and ex-Yugoslavia. Gazprom now owns the Serbian National Oil Company, which, according to things said at the time, was openly purchased with an eye to the influence it would bring, as well as a third of the Portuguese gas company, Galp Energia. It has very close ties with the Austrian energy giant, OMV, and a strong relationship with Ruhrgas in Germany. So if all of these were purely economic relationships, I wouldn't bother to mention them. But in every single country where they've invested, the Russian oil and gas oligarchs have not only lobbied, have also lobbied for financial and banking regulations which will be favorable to their interests, and they have used their money to influence foreign politicians as well. So famously, even a German chancellor, Gerhard Schroeder, was induced to go and work for Gazprom immediately upon leaving office. So thus does Putinism try to preserve itself at home, promote itself abroad, and protect the wealth and power of its leaders. And yet, of course, the ultimate test of an ideology is not whether it can work for a brief period of time, but can it last? If I had given this lecture 5 years ago, I might well have argued that, yes, absolutely it can last. With energy prices still rising and the media monopoly firmly in place, there really seemed no reason to doubt it. The events of the last 18 months, though, mean that I have to be more cautious about the durability of Putinism, as does everybody in the wake of the Arab Spring have to be cautious about predicting anything. But it's true that in recent years, the building blocks of Putinism have begun to look weaker. So clearly the growth of the internet has helped to undermine Putin's media monopoly. Partly as a result, the managed elections, once accepted by Russians without apparent comment, have sparked a series of open protests. It's harder to fool this generation of Russians, or at least harder to get them to roll their eyes, you know, support the traditional fatalism and ignore the obviously falsified elections. At the same time, his own political party and his own civil society organizations, NASHI and other groups, have more recently attracted opprobrium rather than new members because they're associated with official corruption. As a result of these changes, a new Russian opposition has emerged. Unlike its predecessors, its rhetoric and energy are focused not on ideas about human rights, but on corruption, on theft, government theft, and on the lack of transparency in the government and the economy, precisely the things which Putinism depends upon to survive. Meanwhile, the implicit promise of Putinism, we will offer you stability, and a slowly rising standard of living, if you allow us to rule, has been eroded by much slower growth in parts of the country. And a major drop in oil prices would accelerate this process because it would deprive the Russian state budget of most of its revenues. So if the dramatic fall in gas prices in the United States heralds a real change in Europe, then some of Russia's ability to influence the political views of its neighbors might change as well. Certainly the uptick in violence, the harsher legal methods, and the extremely harsh language Putin has used in recent months against the new and still very small political opposition indicate that he too is worried. You know, managed democracy, the whole point of it was to keep these kinds of movements weak and fragmented. So is there anything we can do to help this new opposition, to encourage change in Russia? Speaking frankly, not much. Our ability in the West to alter the course of internal events in Russia is limited, and it always has been. Still, the fact that we have very little influence on the future of Putinism doesn't mean that we have to go along with its central tenet. You know, we don't have to pretend, as the Russian political elite does, that Russia is a democracy or that Russia is a normal member of the Western international community. You know, we don't have to accept its description of its NGOs as foreign agents. We don't even have to continue to allow Russia to remain a member of the G8, which is historically a club for rich democracies. You know, originally, Russia was allowed to attend its meetings on the muddled theory that this would help Russia become a democracy, but it didn't. So why not end the pretense? And the point here is that our standards should remain our standards and our language should remain uncorrupted. But even if we can't do much, the Russians can do a great deal, and I hope we don't make the mistake of underestimating them. One of the things I've learned living on and off in Eastern Europe over the last 20 years is that no country is incapable of change. You know, sooner or later, the generation trained in the mindset of Andropov's KGB will retire. Sooner or later, young Russians will draw their life lessons not from the experiences of the 1990s, but from the experiences of the 2000s. You know, there's no guarantee this new generation will be better or more liberal or more democratic, but it will definitely be different. Perhaps in this context, we should all remember the words of an ancient Slavic proverb taught to me by my mother-in-law. Where there's death, there is hope. Thank you very much.
بهره برداری امن از موبایل و اینترنت، زن، حقوق فردی و اجتماعی، سازوکارهای جلوگیری از نقض حقوق بشر، پویشی در مفهوم دموکراسی، مروری بر پایگیری نهادهای مدنی در ایران، اندیشه‌های نوین از حقوق کارگران، آموزش خبرنگاری، حقوق شهروندی امروز و محیط زیست، توانا، رایگان توانایی ما را به سمت انسان امروزین جهانی متمدن تازه می کند. برای شرکت در این کلاس ها به توانا.org بروید و با جیمیل مستعار ثبت نام کنید. از طریق فیسبوک، توییتر و شبکه یوتیوب می توانید آموزشکده توانا را دنبال کنید. توانا آموزشکده است برای جامعه مدنی ایران.